Hey guys, in this video we will see vitamin K. So let's start. It's a fat-soluble vitamin. There are three types of vitamin K. K1, also called phylloquinone and phytonadione, is synthesized by plants. Vitamin K2 is also called minoquinone and it is synthesized by bacteria. Common cell bacteria in our intestine also synthesize vitamin K2. K3 is called minadione. It's a synthetic analog and it's water-soluble. Coming to its daily requirements. As our intestinal bacteria synthesize vitamin K, its requirement in diet is variable. It's estimated to be about 100 micrograms per day for an average adult. Dietary sources include alfalfa, spinach, cabbage, cauliflower, other green leafy vegetables, egg yolk, meat and dairy products. Its absorption occurs mainly in small intestine. As it's fat soluble, its absorption requires bile salts from liver. It is absorbed in chylomicrons along with fat into the lymphatic channels. It is stored mainly in liver. However, storage does not occur to a larger extent and its level declines rapidly if it is not taken in diet regularly. Now the most interesting part, function. Vitamin K is required for synthesis of clotting factors 2, 7, 9 and 10. Let's see the detail. Clotting factors 2, 7, 9 and 10 have glutamic acid residues. These residues need to be carboxylated for proper functioning of these factors. Gamma-glutamyl carboxylase is the enzyme for this reaction. The reaction also requires oxygen and carbon dioxide. Vitamin K, in its reduced hydroquinone form, works as cofactor in this carboxylation reaction. In the reaction, its active hydroquinone form is converted to oxidized epoxide form, which is inactive. To reactivate vitamin K, we have enzyme vitamin K reductase. This enzyme, with help of NADH, converts vitamin K back to its active reduced form, which can then contribute in carboxylation of other molecules of clotting factors. Now the importance of this carboxylation reaction. Carboxylation provides negative charge to these glutamate residues. This negative charge is essential for its binding with calcium and thereby to membrane phospholipid of platelets. This in turn allows its interaction with other molecules like its own activation and subsequent participation in coagulation. Thus vitamin K is crucial for hemostasis. In fact, it has derived this name because it was initially designated as coagulation vitamin in German because of its role in coagulation. Similarly, vitamin K is also required for carboxylation of protein C and protein S, both of which are anticoagulant factors, osteocalcin found in bones, and some proteins in kidney, lungs, placenta and spleen. Now the deficiency. Vitamin K deficiency is rare as it's synthesized by our intestinal bacteria and enough quantity is usually present in diet. Yet it is seen in some conditions like newborn babies. They are susceptible to vitamin K deficiency because vitamin K does not cross placenta or enter into breast milk in enough quantity. They have very low stores of vitamin K. And also they lack intestinal microflora. Next, prolonged use of antibiotics can suppress intestinal bacteria and cause vitamin K deficiency. Conditions causing malabsorption like biliary obstruction, which impairs access to bile salts, dysentery, enterocolitis, celiac disease, Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis, and resection of intestine can also cause vitamin K deficiency. Hepatocellular disease can lead to manifestations of vitamin K deficiency. However, this is due to incapability of liver cells to synthesize clotting factors rather than actual deficiency of vitamin K. Now pathophysiology. It's very simple if you have understood its function well. If you don't have vitamin K in your body, clotting factors 2, 7, 9 and 10 do not get carboxylated at glutamic acid residues. Without it, they cannot associate with calcium, so all the subsequent effects are lost. This leads to impaired coagulation and increased bleeding tendency. This manifests as bruising, ecchymosis, hematuria, epistaxis, gastrointestinal bleeding, intracranial bleeding, post-operative hemorrhage, and prolonged bleeding and clotting time. Now the uses. It is used in case of its dietary deficiency, malabsorption. In newborns, 1 mg vitamin K by intramuscular route is usually given as prophylaxis. Poisoning with warfarin or similar oral anticoagulants is treated with vitamin K as specific antidote. It's also used in case of prolonged use of antibiotics as they might suppress intestinal microflora and reduce the in-house production of vitamin K. Lastly, it can also be used along with salicylates as they are antagonists to vitamin K and their prolonged use at high dose can cause hypoprothrombinemia. By the way, prothrombin is factor 2. Now the last topic, toxicity. Vitamin K1 and K2, which occur naturally, are considered safe. Toxicity occurs mostly with vitamin K3. It includes hemolysis, hyperbilirubinemia, jaundice, etc., especially in patients with G6PD deficiency and newborns. It can precipitate kernic terrors in newborns as it causes hemolysis and competitively inhibits glucuronidation of bilirubin. Because of this toxicity profile, vitamin K3 should not be used. That's everything for vitamin K. Now it's time for summary. Vitamin K is fat-soluble vitamin. It occurs in three types. K1 is synthesized by plants, K2 by bacteria, and K3 is synthetic and water-soluble. Its daily requirement is variable as it is synthesized by intestinal flora. It is about 100 microgram per day. Dietary sources are alfalfa, spinach, cabbage, cauliflower, other green leafy vegetables, egg yolk, meat and dairy products. Absorption in intestine requires bile salts. Storage occurs mainly in liver. However, it declines rapidly without regular dietary intake. Now functions. Vitamin K is required for synthesis of clotting factors 2, 7, 9 and 10. They are carboxylated by gamma glutamyl carboxylase. The reaction converts active hydroquinone form of vitamin K into inactive epoxide form. Vitamin K reductase reactivates vitamin K utilizing NADH. Carboxylation of these factors is essential for their participation in coagulation. Also, vitamin K is required for synthesis of protein C and protein S, which are anticoagulant factors and osteocalcin. Its deficiency can occur in newborns as vitamin K does not enter into placenta or breast milk in enough quantity. They have low storage and do not have intestinal microflora to synthesize vitamin K. Prolonged antibiotic use destroys intestinal bacteria and causes deficiency. Malabsorption obviously can cause deficiency of any vitamin. In hepatocellular disease, patients develop features of vitamin K deficiency as it is not utilized. Without vitamin K, there is no carboxylation of glutamic acid residues in clotting factors, which impairs coagulation. This increases bleeding tendency, which manifests as bruising, ecchymosis, epistaxis, hematuria, gastrointestinal bleeding, intracranial bleeding, post-operative hemorrhage, and increased bleeding and clotting time. It is used in its dietary deficiency, malabsorption, in newborns, poisoning with warfarin and similar oral anticoagulants, and prolonged use of antibiotics and salicylates. Finally, toxicity profile. Vitamin K1 and 2 are safe. Toxicity usually occurs with vitamin K3. It includes hemolysis, hyperbilirubinemia, and jaundice, and precipitation of kernic terrors in newborns. So vitamin K3 should not be used. That's it friends for this video. If you found this video helpful, please share it with your friends. And if you didn't, tell me in the comment section below so that I can make improvements in upcoming videos. And in either case, don't forget to subscribe because lots more to come. Thank you for watching. See you in next video.